by the suggestions that we choose to accept.
Have you ever wanted to quit writing, ever?
No. I've been really tired, writing. I'm physically tired. But no, the ideas are always, it's like a sunrise. You ever get tired of watching a sunrise?
No.
Well, after a while, the sunrise becomes noon and it becomes a sunset. But tomorrow's another sunrise, and it's fascinating if you happen to be up and around at that time to see the light come up in the sky. I feel the same way about writing, that there are those ideas that suddenly come that are like sunrises, that are so fascinating. They're so nourishing to explore those ideas and at the same time to be writing them down. See what characters come along, if it's going to be a fiction story, what characters are, or if it's going to be nonfiction, to look back into your own life and say, oh, now I realize why this had to happen, because if that hadn't happened, this wouldn't have happened. Our lives are matrices
yes.
of coincidence. And it is, any one of us can look back. You can say to a lot of people, how did you meet your mate? And with very few exceptions, it was a wild coincidence. I never should have met her at all. You know, but it just so happened that her friend happened to be walking by, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We ask ourselves those questions. The important times in my life, how did they happen? Very often we'll say, well, it just seems to be coincidence. Then we look farther and say, well, maybe it's not coincidence. Maybe there's an inner guidance that's going on. Maybe there are little guardian angels flapping around here and kind of helping us out in difficult times.
Has the stress, not only the delight of writing, but the stress once the book is done, packaged, and out there, the being in the world, needing to manifest the money in between books, ever affected or impacted your relationships, your most important relationships?
Boy, that's a good question, Kim.
Thank you. It comes from a rabbinic place.
Yeah, it takes a special companion, a special mate, who can say, everything's going to work out. Because in writing, or in any of these same creative calling, you don't know. You don't know if this book is going to sell at all, let alone sell enough to allow you to survive. But there's a level of belief that's required. And over the years, I've gotten to trust that belief that I'm given these ideas for a reason. There are certain people out there in the world who can benefit from them. I trust that first I'll be able to write a story that's interesting enough to hold their attention, and second, that there'll be enough of them that they'll buy enough books that I can go on flying my little airplane, right? And somehow, that's just worked out. If I wanted to guarantee it to someone, I couldn't do it. I could just say, well, that word you used before, you trust. I'm doing the best I know how to be the best writer I can be, the best human being I can be. And sometimes I fail at both of them terribly. But overall, I'm working in that direction. That's what I want. I want to write beautiful stories. I want to write stories that touch me first. If they touch me, I'm a fairly average person. They'll touch other people like me if they can find them.
You sound like an old soul.
Well, you live on this kind of hope, right? And you create what may very well be a fiction. None of this may be true. But I do believe that we're all of us led and guided and protected at certain times. And that seems to be true in my life. I accept that as true. And I assume that it's not suddenly going to quit. Your guardian angels are suddenly going to say, well, it was nice knowing you. We'll see you around.
I have another question. Jonathan Livingston Seagull, where did that name come up? Did you come up with that name?
How do you define you?
Yeah, that's great. Let's do another hour on how you define you. Can we do that? Let's suspend our need to deal with that question, because I think that's an hour just chipping around at it. Well, I guess my question to you then, I'll restate. We'll pretend we're in a court of law. Sir, did Jonathan come to you in the writing of that book, or was Jonathan brought to you after it was completed?
Jonathan was unlike, in its intensity, it was unlike any book I've done. I was a brand new beginning writer. I was stepping on that raft for one of the first times. And I was, as you were saying, worrying about how am I going to pay the rent. I was walking at night alone, and I heard a voice. Somebody behind me said, "Jonathan Livingston Seagull," in just about that tone. It wasn't a male, it wasn't a female. I just heard that. And it scared me, and because I thought I was alone. I turned around, and there was nobody there behind me to the right. I heard that, and I'm not psychic. And yet here's this thing, strange thing. And I went home and locked the door and said, "What does that mean?" And I had no clue. And I sat down. It was late at night. I said, "Come on, voice. Did you mean to talk to somebody else to whom this means something? Because honestly, I don't understand." And no reply. Silence, utter silence. I said, "That has got to be the weirdest thing that's ever happened in my life." And then just when I was giving up about midnight, the wall disappeared, and here was this movie screen, and all of a sudden, well, it wasn't a movie screen, it was like empty air. I was flying up high, and here's the sea down below, and here's this little seagull flying along. And I said, "That's what a Jonathan Livingston seagull is," and I knew, like in a dream, I just knew who he was. I knew his heart. I knew what he was striving for. All this stuff instantly. And I just started writing. And that time I was writing by hand. Green ballpoint pen, I will never forget. Wrote as fast as I could write about here it was morning, and here's this little seagull flying along, and he's way up high. And the flock is way down below him. Little tiny specks down below. But he's practicing flying. And that was fascinating to me because I'm obviously a flyer and I love this stuff. And so that just carried me. And I was just, I'm stunned by this strange vision. And then all of a sudden two-thirds of the way through part one, where he does this crazy flying, he gets thrown out of the flock. All of a sudden, woof. Somebody tripped over the power cord to this movie, and the scene disappears, and I'm looking at a blank wall. And it's like something is saying, if you think you're inventing this, invent the rest, Richard. And I had no clue when I started thinking about it. Well, let's see, if I were a seagull, I've just been thrown out of the flock, and I've done this crazy flying. What do? I fight them. I fight them. I fight back. No, oh, come on, you don't. Fight back. What do I do? And I had no idea what I would do. And I finally put it away. Manuscript's unfinished. I remember that file. There were these pages and pages of green ballpoint pens. And I finally, no, there was no answer. 8 years later. Eight years.
Oh, my God.
I was living in Iowa, 1,500 miles away from California. I woke up from a dream, 5 o'clock in the morning. Great thing about being a writer is you can sleep as late as you want. 5 o'clock in the morning, wham, that's the ending to that story. I know, no, it's downstairs, that story, yes. Now I have an electric typewriter, and I type as fast as I can type. And there's the end of part one, and bam, there was part two, there was part three.
That's awesome.
Where did this come from? Why did it wait? I have no clue, right? But here's this story, and sure enough, if it came in this strange way, it is going to just sell first time out. Fastest rejection I've ever had. No, thank you. It's not our cup of tea. Oh, dear, no. Not a talking seagull, Richard. How can this happen? How does this stuff come in this strange way, and then it's rejected? Is this my life? And then coincidence, right? Then I go out. They've repossessed the car. I go out, and I'm standing in the driveway by my mailbox. I get two pieces of mail. one piece of mail is an envelope. I know what that is.